And welcome. Yes, you are listening, and you are listening to a live show here. Three women. I'm your host, Sherry DeNovo, MPP Parkdale High Park. And of course, what else would we be speaking about a week before the federal election, but federal politics. And for the first half hour, we've got Linda McQuaig, who is the NDP candidate in Toronto Centre. And for the second half hour, we've got Angela Salewsky. She's a Lakeshore, Etobicoke-Lakeshore candidate for the Green Party. We're going to be talking about all things woman-esque and all things political in this federal election. So stay tuned. And by the way, you can reach us on Twitter at CHERIDINOVO. Tweet your thoughts, tweet your questions, tweet your concerns, or you can phone in at 416-946-7000. Yes, you do have an hour before the Jays start to play. Spend it with us. And so without further ado, let's go to our first guest. Linda, are you there?
I'm here.
Wonderful.
Great to be with you, Sherry.
Yes, welcome. So it's the last week of a long, grueling campaign.
Yes, indeed.
How are you feeling?
Well, actually, I'm feeling great. I mean, you know, for one thing, there's just a huge amount of adrenaline that kicks in at this point. You know, we've been working all weekend, and the final week is coming up, and it's, you know, you can feel the energy of the home stretch.
Yeah. And it's interesting. I mean, it's a campaign that's kind of had its ups and downs and all arounds. And but in your particular riding in Toronto Centre, you're running against, actually, it's interesting. I once worked in a company that was owned by his father, Morneau and Associates.
Oh, yeah.
You're running against the younger Morneau, who, if you read his resume, looks like a conservative. He was, you know, headed up a C.D. Howe.
Yes, Institute. No, exactly. I mean, he's the Liberal candidate. But as you say, his resume could lead you to think otherwise. He's a Bay Street businessman and former chairman of the C.D. Howe Institute, which I think is interesting, because I think it reminds us that, you know, the Liberal Party, you know, in this election campaign, we've heard an awful lot about them presenting themselves as progressive. But it reminds us that, in fact, you know, the business wing of the party is very powerful within the Liberal Party. And, you know, we've seen this before where they, you know, run a very progressive campaign, talk about progressive issues and all the things they're going to invest in. Saw this in 1993 federally. And then they got into power. And very quickly after taking power, you know, the cuts began under Paul Martin's austerity budget. You know, I think we just have to remember the importance of the ties between Bay Street and the Liberal Party.
If you're tuning in and you don't know who Linda McQuaig is, shame on you, by the way. I should tell you a little bit about her background. I mean, a couple of things that I think that kind of fun are the quotes from the right-wing press about her. National Post called her Canada's Michael Moore.
They meant that as an insult, by the way.
Yes, I'm sure.
And I was quite flattered, needless to say.
Yes, of course. But the best one, I think, is, you know, that man we all love to hate, Conrad Black, who said you should be horsewhipped. I remember that. Like it was yesterday. I mean, there is no higher praise. Come on, Linda. Also, of course, the author of 11 books, has written for just about everybody. And actually, interestingly enough, since we're sitting in U of T's campus here, you worked on the Varsity. I didn't realize that.
Yes,
you and Thomas Walcombe.
Co-editor of the Varsity along with Tom Walcombe, who's now, of course, a columnist at the Toronto Star.
Fascinating. So getting back to your particular race in Toronto Centre, certainly across downtown Toronto, we're seeing a lot of strategic voters, people who definitely want to get Harper out, but kind of aren't sure who to vote for. What do you say at the door to such voters?
Well, okay, first of all, I agree. Job one is getting rid of Stephen Harper. He's done such damage to this country, and that is just vital. We get rid of, put the Harper years behind us. But, you know, I mean, certainly if we're talking about Toronto Centre, we're really talking about a two-way race. You know, the polls clearly show it's between the Liberals and the NDP. The Conservatives are certainly not a factor, barely running a campaign here. So whether you vote Liberal, whether you vote NDP, you're voting for, you know, a party that's opposed to Harper. So it's not really an issue here. You know, you can vote either one and be confident that you're doing your duty to get rid of Harper.
Mm-hmm. I noticed just recently Justin Trudeau has kind of taken a new tack, which is to reach out to the conservative voter and say, you know, come along with us.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, I think that, you know, as I was saying, I think the truth is that, you know, both the Liberals and the Conservatives have close ties with, you know, powerful interests with Bay Street and the, you know, the big business. And, you know, so you can sort of understand that Trudeau might think he could shave off some of those right-wing voters, some of those conservative voters, you know. But I guess, you know, again, it comes down to where are the basic allegiances. You know, when you think of, let's say, working people, you know, I remember the Labor Day parade only a few weeks ago at the beginning of September. The NDP, of course, is out in force. Tom Mulcair was leading the parade arm in arm with national labor leaders. Where was Justin Trudeau? He wasn't even there. You know, they don't even bother to show up. Their allegiances are not with labor. They're not with working people. You know, they're ultimately with Bay Street.
And yet, is, you know, so many of the union membership vote Liberal. In fact, some vote Conservative.
Yeah. Well, listen, everybody, of course, you know, does their own thing. But I find that often when I meet people and when I sort of talk to them about this and they kind of realize, you know, where the party's ultimate allegiances are, I think that's very influential with people. I mean, it, you know, part of the problem with these election campaigns is, you know, there's so many words flying around out there and all the parties trying to, you know, say things that will appeal to average voters, you know, ordinary people, because that's where, you know, that's who most Canadians are. And there's not a lot of good analysis by the media kind of clarifying what the parties actually stand for. So it's not surprising people are confused. You know, when I look at something, you know, take something like the health care issue. I was reading in the Star this morning, and they were talking all about how it was such an important issue, and people should, you know, the future of Medicare was at stake. But they never went on to, you know, they were saying how important it was that people voted. They never went on to explain that, in fact, the NDP is really the only party that's going to reverse the $36 billion in cuts that Stephen Harper's already put in place to come into effect in 2017, over the following 10 years, that'll come out of funding for public health care. The NDP is the only party that's pledged to reverse that. The Conservatives are obviously not going to reverse it. They're doing it. And the Liberals haven't said. The NDP has pledged to reverse that. Why isn't that in the media coverage? I mean, it's just so frustrating to me to see that.
Mm-hmm. Now, you are and were a media person, and you wrote for said papers. I mean, obviously, the Toronto Star has come out and endorsed Justin Trudeau in this election. That's pretty clear. But do you find you're looking at mainstream media with new eyes now that you're actually running?
I mean, I looked at the mainstream media with quite, you know, critical eyes even when I was in it. I mean, you know, and certainly when I was a columnist, I was a columnist for many years for the Toronto Star, and you know, as a columnist, you have quite a bit of freedom. And I was, you know, among other things, very critical of the media. But, you know, I almost think that often it's the media gets caught up in this idea that, you know, they can't take positions, although, as you point out, they have no hesitation editorially in endorsing certain candidates. But they feel like if they have an article on health care or on housing or on child care or whatever, you know, that they shouldn't kind of take positions. But they, you know, in the middle of an election. But what I think would be useful is if they at least laid out accurately what the different parties have stood for and are proposing. I mean, without that, it's so difficult for voters to even figure out where the parties stand on various issues.
Well, I mean, it clearly, the Toronto Star, with a couple of exceptions. They endorsed Jack, but only at the very end in 2011, but has clearly been a big L liberal newspaper. Clearly, the Toronto Sun is a conservative paper.
Right.
I guess one could argue there really isn't a Labour Party. We don't have a Guardian. And,
we don't. We don't, unfortunately. You know, it's so ironic because everybody sort of, or you often hear this kind of dismissal of the media's left wing. I don't know where they get that idea, because certainly the NDP, I think, gets pretty short shrift in the, you know, I don't want to overstate that. I mean, I think they do report on things that the NDP does, but as you say, you know, the mainstream papers pretty much always end up endorsing either the Conservatives or the Liberals. But, you know, when you think about it, that's not terribly surprising when you realize that those mainstream newspapers, of course, are ultimately owned by large corporations. And, you know, it isn't that surprising that they would endorse candidates or endorse parties that they feel closest to as you know, that they will represent their business interests. But I just think it's so misleading, because I think a lot of people don't necessarily see that, and they, you know, think that these parties are being judged on something other than their affiliations or their closeness to business positions.
Just lastly, while we're still on the media, one last thing: CBC, of course, is fighting for its life, really.
Yes.
Under a Harper government, certainly was fighting for its life, and they seem to have. I mean, this is just me, but they seem to have drifted into the Liberal camp as well, which I find somewhat surprising, considering the Liberals also cut funding from the CBC.
Yeah, it certainly is the case that the Liberals were the ones that really began the big CBC cuts. You know, it increased or continued under Harper, but the really massive cuts to the CBC actually were under the Liberal government. That is certainly true.
Now, moving on, looking at the strategies of the parties in terms of how they've run this election, one of the things that was quite surprising, I don't think that anybody really predicted, was what the Conservatives did under, as he's called, the Lizard of Oz, Mr. Crosby, as their strategist. Right. And all of a sudden, everybody's talking about a NICAB, which never was part of, we never heard about it at the door.
That issue, you know, was not one that ever came up at the door, I can assure you of that. Yeah, I saw a great cartoon about this where they showed the NICAB as the tip of a big iceberg. The big iceberg under the water was, you know, all the big issues that are being ignored by the media in this campaign, and all the media focus on this little tip of the iceberg. But let's face it, that's exactly the politics that Stephen Harper wanted to play. He wanted to turn that into a wedge issue, which he thought would play to his advantage, even though obviously it had the potential to arouse racism and divisiveness. He didn't care about that. He just wanted to try and arouse his base with it. And unfortunately, the media has cooperated to a far greater extent than it should have.
And of course, you know, talking about this debate, I mean, this has also helped the Bloc, of course, stir this up in Quebec. Interestingly, I mean, I think that Mulcair took a very principled stand on this issue, even though it may have cost him in some of the, you know, the rural areas of Quebec. But, you know, Justin Trudeau's stand isn't that different, yet it seems to have, you know, hurt, if anybody, Mulcair more than him. What's your analysis of that?
Well, I think Mulcair has staked out some very principled territory there, as you say. And, you know, I think he knew that it was going to cost him. But, you know, he thought that was the principled position, that it wasn't up to governments to dictate how women dress. I think it was a principled position. You know, it does sort of remind me of the of the Bill C-51 issue. You know, that was another case. The Harper government brought in that so-called anti-terrorism legislation right after the attack on Parliament, and, you know, the country was still somewhat traumatized by the attack on Parliament, and so there seemed to be a lot of support for that legislation at the beginning. And so Trudeau, for instance, came out and supported it. Mulcair took the difficult position of saying, no, we can't support this. This is a serious compromise on the human and civil rights of Canadians. And you know, to his credit, he stuck with that principled position. And it's turned out that that is what, you know, most people now recognize to be the correct position. You know, we've now had four former Supreme Court justices come out and say this is Bill C-51 is too big of a compromise on Canadian civil liberties and should be rejected. You know, so Mulcair had the bravery and the integrity to take that position from the beginning, whereas the Liberals voted for it. So it doesn't surprise me to see Mulcair do this again in connection with the NECAB. And, you know, in this case, he's, you know, perhaps taking a bit of a hit over it. You know, I guess I just sort of think in the long run, if you take positions that are principled and you do the right thing, I think in the long run, the public will respect you and that's the right thing to do anyway.
Now, what issues are you hearing at the door in Toronto Centre?
I guess the big, you know, the biggest issue is around affordable housing. You know, I often go to doors and, you know, I mean, there's a lot of poverty. You can mm-hmm. tell before the door opens, you're in a pretty troubled building. You know, I hear stories about, you know, people paying, you know, I've heard like more than 50% of their income in rent, you know, like 60% sometimes. You know, that is just crisis proportions. So anything around housing is a huge issue in Toronto Centre. And you know, you can't help but realize that, you know, we had a pretty good housing program in this country, you know, through the 70s, 80s, and 90s, actually pushed in place by pressure from the NDP back in the early 70s. The Liberals brought it in, and it was a pretty good program. You know, that's how we got a lot of the good co-ops and non-profit housing in the area. But it was killed by the Liberals in 1996 as part of Paul Martin's austerity. You know, and that unleashed just the huge problem of homelessness, you know, just made it crisis proportions and precarious, people precariously housed. So that's the biggest issue. And I guess all the issues kind of related to that, related to housing, poverty, just people having low incomes and just struggling to get by. Mm-hmm. You know, I saw a statistic the other day that just leapt out at me. 37.8% of children in Toronto Centre are living in poverty. You know, the poverty rate for the country is 19%, child poverty rate, which is way too high. But we're almost double that in Toronto Centre.
And I think in the downtown Toronto ridings, you're really seeing that stark contrast, too. I mean, really, you can only live downtown Toronto if you're rich enough to afford a house.
Yeah.
And they're expensive, extremely expensive, or you're a renter.
Yeah.
And you're precariously housed. There's not a whole lot in the middle there anymore in downtown, which is now in York, in the case of Toronto Centre, the borders were redrawn since the last by-election that you fought there.
That's right.
Has that changed the nature of the riding?
It does change it quite a bit, particularly the northern border used to go all the way up to St. Clair in parts. Now it doesn't go any farther north than Bloor. So, you know, the riding no longer includes Rosedale, obviously one of the richest parts of the country. It used to be like such a riding of extremes. Like you'd have Rosedale, one of the richest neighborhoods in the country, and then you'd have Moss Park and St. Jamestown, you know, some serious poverty in some of those areas. Now, without Rosedale, I mean, you still have some affluent parts and through Cabbage Town and the Village, but it's much more predominantly low income. So, you know, that has changed the nature of the riding a bit. But I think certainly that's better for the NDP because we are closer to ordinary Canadians and want to defend the rights of low-income Canadians. I think it's also just made it a little bit more coherent as a riding. I think it was really, you know, the extremes of rich and poor were, you know, really kind of made the riding almost incoherent the way it was before. So I do think it's better this way.
Mm-hmm. So next to housing, what's something else? Well, you also have the village, the LGBTQ village in your...
LGBTQ issues are extremely big. Mm-hmm. And, you know, of course, you know those issues better than anyone, Sherry. This is the home of the Gay Pride Parade and all, just organizing around LGBTQ issues. That's, of course, extremely important.
And C-279, which is the trans...
Right, yes.
...human rights
trans,
bill federally.
Yeah, absolutely.
There was such...
And the NDP, of course, has been championing that. And
which has been such a... was such a, you know, I mean, a heartbreaker.
First of all, they amended it, and then they didn't even pass it.
Screwed
up again in the mm-hmm. Senate. My mm-hmm. God, yet another reason why we must get rid of the Senate.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, the great work that you've done on conversion therapy and getting that banned—that is, of course, you know, terrific.
Well, we're still at it now. We're looking at parent equality and trying to now. Sadly, same-sex couples are having to adopt their own children in Ontario, which is very different from, say, BC, where they don't have to
right.
do that. So for you coming from such a different background, I mean, you're an author, everybody knows who you are, you have profile, and you're a columnist, and all of a sudden you're spending your days knocking, talking, walking in politics. What have been some of the surprises for you, when you threw yourself into
walking,
it?
How much walking, talking, and knocking is involved? But you know, the truth is, yes, there is that difference, but in many ways it feels like a continuum from what I've done before because, you know, in my years as a journalist and author, I was always focused on issues of income inequality and you know, the need for stronger social programs and a more inclusive society and all those issues. And those are the same issues that I'm focused on as a candidate. So, you know, that part feels very familiar to me, and I, you know, get to discuss and debate and engage on the same issues. The difference is, in addition to moving around more rather than sitting at a desk all day, in addition, it's more engagement with people. I mean, it's just really that aspect of it is, what is most engaging and most interesting about it. Like, I just came from the Good Shepherd Thanksgiving lunch. You know, they put on a magnificent lunch down there for, I think it's 1,600 people, in shifts, and just engaging with the people, coming in for lunch, you know, lined up around the block, just having such interesting conversations with them. I've been writing about issues that affect, low-income people for a long time, but I've got much more direct involvement with them now than I ever had, and that's extremely satisfying to me.
Now, you're also a woman running against a man there, and a strong feminist from way back. Any surprises there, or any learnings as, you know, you're a woman in politics, not just another politician that's a male?
That's true. I think, if anything, there's a lot of people that are happy to see a woman candidate and happy to get behind a woman candidate. I sense a kind of support for me as a woman as well as a activist. So if anything, I think there's quite a difference between me. Woman activist, long time fighter on income inequality, between me and a kind of Bay Street man, a little bit part of the old boys network there. I think there's a lot of people that, recognize that I'm you know, I'm more of an outsider, and I'm going to fight for them, and I'm not part of any old boys network. I'm going to be there for them and fight for their issues.
How have the all candidates meetings gone? Usually they're pretty raucous in Toronto Centre, I seem to recall.
Yes, but civil, I would say. You know, mm-hmm. we've had some lively debates, no question. I will say one thing. I mean, I want to say this about all the candidates. You know, everybody's conducted themselves in a very civilized manner, and, you know, I appreciated that about the all candidates debates and about the race in general. I think it's, you know, there's certainly some disagreements, some sharp disagreements on a lot of different issues, but and there's been attacks back and forth, as there should be, but, you know, a pretty civilized debate altogether, which is, you know, a nice aspect of our democracy.
And the one last question, Linda, the day after whatever happens on the 19th, the day after, what do you have planned?
I can honestly say I have no plans for October 20th.
Will you sleep in?
In the sense that, you know, I'll have, you know, I'm certainly hoping and expecting to win. And then, of course, if I do, then my life will take off in, you know, I'll be just so excited about organizing and, you know, getting ready to defend Toronto Centre and get to Ottawa and everything. But at this point, we're just so focused on winning what is going to be a very, very tight race from all the polls. I haven't a chance to think of exactly what October 20th would look like, other than I hope that we're celebrating and getting to work.
Well, at least we hope here from Three Women that you get a little bit of rest, whatever happens on the 20th. Anyway, lovely to talk to you. Get out there, go knock, walk, talk, and we'll be following you closely. In fact, I'm reporting on it, on one of the major media on that night, so I'll be watching you.
Thanks so
Take
much,
care.
Mary. Great to talk to you.
That was, of course, Linda McQuaig, a columnist, author, and activist running in Toronto Centre for the NDP. Next up, we're going to have Angela Salewsky from the Green Party running at Etobicoke Lakeshore. Different riding, different issues, but we're going to take a break for a few minutes and listen to Brave Shores.
right now, every day. CIUT 89.5, Toronto. Sound of your city.
And welcome back. You are listening to Three Women live here at 89.5 CIUT FM. And of course, we were just speaking to Linda McQuaig from Toronto Centre. And now we're delighted to have Angela Salewsky on the phone. Angela, welcome to Three Women.
Thank you. It's great to be on the show.
And I just left off with Linda. I'm going to start off with the same question for you. Whatever happens on October the 20th, what will you be doing that day?
I am going to go see my mother in Waterloo.
So that at least you have a plan. That's a good one.
Yes.
Now, just a little bit about Angela. She's a volunteer with just about everybody, including the World Wildlife Fund. She's been part of the Lakeshore Planning Council. She's running for the Green Party in Etobicoke-Lakeshore, and she's a business development manager in the security industry, which is not what you would normally think the profile would be for somebody running for the Green Party. So fill us in a little bit, Angela.
No, that's true. What I do for a living, really, I consider what I do to pay the bills. My passion has always been things like environmental issues and animal welfare issues. And when I discovered the Green Party about 10 years ago and fell in love with the policies and everything it represents, I decided that this was something I wanted to pursue. So I got involved that way. I was always politically involved and a bit of a political junkie. I was conservative before, interestingly enough, more from the influence of my father. But like I said, when I discovered the Green Party, I thought it was something that I really wanted to get involved with. And of course, for the most part, you have to do that on your own time, volunteering, and it's unpaid.
Absolutely. And it seems to me that certainly the environment hasn't really been front and center in this election in terms of the mainstream media coverage. Is that your impression too?
Well, yep. There are a lot of issues that we know aren't getting addressed in mm-hmm. this campaign. And yeah, the environment and even diversifying our economy, healthcare, you know, you were talking a bit about that with Linda.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of issues aren't getting addressed. And unfortunately, it seems to be those divisive ones like what you and Linda were discussing.
Oh, the niqab. I mean, who knew that would be an issue, you know, for the two women that actually wanted to get their citizenship and wore it. I mean, it's astounding.
Yes. So the environment really isn't getting the attention it needs. And that's what people are also saying at the door. Now, they may very well be telling me this. As the Green candidate, they may not be telling other candidates that when they're at the door, but that is something people are mentioning to me that should be getting more attention, and particularly those that do support us here in the riding.
So what led to your concern for the environment? I mean, what was the sort of the change point in your life, do you think, when that became preeminent for you?
Sorry?
When you first became really focused on the environment and interested in the environment, what was the changing point in your life, really, that brought that about?
Well, I think because I had volunteered with World Wildlife Fund, and I know from volunteering there how so little of Canada's big expanse was actually really protected. And that's where I started getting my awareness from. And then when Harper came on the scene, it was pretty clear to me right from the beginning that he didn't really have any real focus on that. And then, of course, as he got his majority and started with the cuts through the omnibus budget bills, stripping away all the protections that were there, that really got to me. And so I got even more involved. And that's when I became the candidate provincially. I was so angry about those cuts in the omnibus budget bill that he pretty much allowed the oil and gas industry to rewrite all our legislation because, as they said, that legislation was focused on preventing bad things from happening. go figure. That really made me angry, and that's when I really stepped up and got involved as a candidate myself.
Now, Etobicoke-Lakeshore has had quite the history. Do you want to just, because for listeners who may be, closer to downtown, who may not know who even the incumbent is now, do you want to give us a little bit of a background on who's the sitting MP and what's up the door there?
Well, it's Bernard Trottier, a Conservative MP. He got in as MPP the last election, 2011. The general consensus is that he won his MP position mostly because the riding was upset with Michael Ignatieff,
who was the candidate, their leader of the Liberals.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes, and we did vote him in once, but. He said he would move to the riding. He never moved to the riding. He stayed living in Yorkville. People didn't really like that. People here like to have the candidate be locally entrenched and be in the community. And Michael Ignatieff just wasn't. And people felt he wasn't really looking after the interests of the riding. So in that last election, we voted him out, and Bernard Trottier lives in the area, and he's been in the area for a while. And so collectively, I guess the riding voted in a Conservative MP.
And now I think it's a little closer, isn't it, according to the polls? Not that they're the greatest indication always, but still. Yeah, and who's the Liberal candidate running against him?
James Maloney, yes. It looks like he is in the lead. I think, 41% was the one the other day. Hmm. And Bernard Trottier, I think, mid or high 30s. So
it's very close.
It is close, but it looks like they're projecting a win for James Maloney. And then, of course, Lead Now, who we're all familiar with, has come out now and endorsed James Maloney, because as a Conservative riding and a swing riding, Lead Now has been very active in the riding.
Mm-hmm. And tell it, for listeners again who aren't really sure of what that is, can you tell them a little bit about that? What is that?
Well, Lead Now is it's, I guess, a grassroots organization as well, and their whole mandate is really to have people, as they say, vote together to get Harper out. So that's their mandate across the country. They're pretty well organized, it seems, and they seem to have been successful in raising funds for their cause. So I certainly understand it, because with our first-past-the-post, winner-take-all system, I think a lot of people feel that that's really the only way to get Harper out and to get a little more progressive focus.
I mean, certainly we think that that should change. I mean, we need proportional representation of some sort. It's ridiculous that, the votes for you, for example, will not probably count in any way, shape, or form.
Yes. Well, the people who vote for us in this riding, we do have a small but loyal base of Green Party supporters who would not vote for any other party but Green Party. So, that's really why I'm doing this, is really for them and the team. I hear that a lot at the door, of course. I mean, everybody seems to really support what we're about and like our broad policies, but of course they want to vote strategically, and they do keep telling me, well, once we get another government in, the Liberals and the NDP have assured us that we're going to have electoral reform and we're going to have proportional representation, so the next election we can vote for you. So we are definitely, I think,
which must be frustrating for you at the door, though, isn't it?
Pardon?
Is it that frustrating for you at the door?
Oh, boy. I repeat this in my sleep every night, I'm sure. Yeah. But, you have to brace yourself for that. And being with the Green Party, I think I have to expect a little bit of that. So I'm definitely practical and realistic. But yes, it gets very frustrating.
Did you take some time off from your work to do this?
Yeah.
Yeah, you did. You took a leave of absence to focus on it. So, you know, you heard me ask Linda about the walking, talking, knocking. But I mean, as you move from your work into doing this, what are, you know, the life of a full-time politician, basically. What were some of the surprises for you?
Some of the surprises? Oh, boy. Actually, there are people who aren't really thinking of the election.
Mm-hmm. Even now. I know, three months later. Yeah.
Yeah. Because, you know, we're living and breathing it. I guess because of that, and because I'm a political junkie regardless, I would think everybody's interested in this election, particularly since what's been happening since Harper's had his majority. So I actually find that surprising. Maybe I shouldn't, because most people aren't thinking about politics in their day-to-day lives, and they're busy, and they have families, and they have work, and everything else that they have going on in their lives. But I still find that surprising when I do hear from time to time, oh, I haven't even thought about it. It doesn't affect me.
Now, you in Etobicoke-Lakeshore have some of the same kind of mix that, in a sense, that they have in Toronto Centre, even though housing stock generally is a little bit cheaper than downtown Toronto. But I mean, you've got some very wealthy people living there, and you've got some people who are extremely poor.
Yeah.
And are you hearing, poverty issues at the door as you're making the rounds?
Well, certainly the concern about the ending of the funding for affordable housing and co-op housing and the rent-to-income supplement, because we do have quite a few co-ops in the riding. And, yeah, we do have a bit of a dichotomy, too. You know, we've got the Kingsway, which is a wealthy area, and then we have pockets, particularly more in the south end of the riding, where we have a number of co-op housing. And we did have a forum in the riding on co-op and affordable housing. So that's definitely a concern, because it will lead to people not being able to afford to live, because there won't be those supplements there. And then all the upkeep that's going to be needed for the co-op won't be there. So that's something that on that end of the spectrum they're really concerned about. So we want to see the funding restored and maintained when the federal government commitment ends. So yeah, that is definitely an issue.
Now, you have something also in common with you know, downtown ridings like Toronto Centre. You've got a lot of condos.
Oh, yes.
Which, for those out there in listener land who may not quite know what it's like to canvass, that's quite a challenge, canvassing. You feel like you're in a building forever, going from the top to the bottom.
Right.
Are there issues related to the condo dwellers? Are condo dwellers different in their political viewpoints?
Well, yes and no. They have, you know, the same concerns, I think, generally, but certainly the lack of infrastructure planning affects the whole riding and those living in the condos, because we haven't really had the planning. And this was a huge issue provincially as well, you know, with the traffic and the infrastructure is insufficient. There's not enough good transit. And there hasn't been the planning to accommodate the big influx of the condos. And basically on one corner at Lakeshore and Park Lawn, it's almost, you know, the size of a small city of population on one street corner, and without any of the infrastructure planning.
Now, Peter Milchin is your member of provincial parliament, got elected there. Have you, you know, had any dealings with him since his election?
No, actually, I have not spoken with him at all. But I know, you know, that was an issue that came up provincially, so he wants to address that. And I know there's talk of a hub at the old Christie site. So it sounds like we do have plans in the place, and there's things that we want to get done. But of course, we need cooperation at all levels. So we need the federal government at the table, and I think we also need a national transit plan, which Canada, we're really the only OECD country that doesn't have a national transit strategy.
Which is quite shocking when you think about it, really. And now, Angela, you, I'm sure, don't take part in all candidates' panels as part of your day job. So what was it like for you for the first time when you were up there on the stage in an all-candidates debate? What was that experience like?
Well, you know, we are maybe the only riding, at least in Toronto, we haven't really had debate. We had one right at the very beginning of the campaign in August. It was put on by the South Etobicoke Youth Alliance on youth issues, and that was right at the beginning. But we've had a number of debates that were scheduled, including one at the Etobicoke School of the Arts, canceled because Bernard Trottier would not participate, and then James Maloney didn't want to participate if Bernard Trottier wasn't participating. So we've had, and that's really about it. We've had a forum, as I was mentioning, on affordable housing and co-ops, but that was each candidate speaking for about 20 minutes, half an hour individually. But Bernard Trottier wasn't at that one either.
What is with that? I don't get that as a strategy, but it seems to be not just in your riding of Etobicoke-Lakeshore, but it seems to be a strategy of conservatives generally that they're just not showing up for all candidates' debates. I was at one on LGBTQ issues, and the chair was empty there too.
Yeah.
What do you think that's about?
Well, you know, we know that it's more or less coming from the top. You know, Harper doesn't really want them participating too much, so that nobody really gets into too much trouble. But I guess some have been participating somewhat. But it's from the top. And so he's, you know, muzzling, in addition to the scientists, he's muzzling his own candidates and MPs. And look at even Joe Oliver. We haven't heard too much from him either. So it's coming from the top. And that, to me, is also a suppression of democracy, because people aren't even allowed to hear what their conservative candidates have to say on a local basis.
And by the way, if you've just tuned in, you're listening to Three Women at CIUT 89.5 FM. I'm your host, Sherry DeNovo, MPP Parkdale High Park, and we're talking to Angela Salewsky, who's the Green Party candidate in Etobicoke-Lakeshore, and not her first kick at this can. She was also the Green Party candidate for the provincial election as well. How do the two differ, Angela? Is there like a different feeling running federally and provincially? Not too many people have that experience. You have.
Right. Well, this federal election, I think, is probably in particular a little different. I think we're really at a crossroads now federally, and I think people are really realizing that we really have a lot on the line. So it's feeling like it's a lot more critical, and even maybe a lot more desperate, because people are really afraid what's happened to us, what's happened to our country, and what direction it's taking. So it really has a real critical feel that something has to give, something has to change, and people are afraid. That certainly wasn't the case provincially, even though particularly the last one last year, I was getting a lot that they didn't want the conservatives in, but it didn't have that really desperate feel like it does now. And I really think people are getting desperate.
Certainly with Paris coming up, if you can, you know, the a conference there if you are concerned about the environment and climate change, which again doesn't seem to be getting it much play in the mainstream media at all. Our role internationally on issues like climate change has been severely hurt, I would think. But, you know, how do you feel as a Green Party member about that?
Well, of course, it's very, very, very frustrating. The message just isn't getting out, and it's very critical. And even though, you know, that's what the party is known for, it's also, I think, a reflection of how bad a state our democracy as a whole is. Because if we did have a more open democracy, then these issues could be getting out on the table as well. But it's a very controlled message from the top now. And even as Linda was saying, you know, that the media isn't necessarily talking about these other issues like, you know, climate change and the environment and healthcare and such. And the media perhaps is playing into the controlled messaging that Harper's trying to keep control of. So it's very frustrating because these are critical issues that affect us all. And environmental issues do affect the economy. You know, you can't really have a good economy when the environment's suffering and when climate change is happening and when we're not taking the means and planning, you know, doing any kind of climate change mitigation planning, because we're going to be feeling it as well in the city. So,
I mean, you are an interesting case in the sense that you've had this business background. You work in the business sphere. And you know, I think I was it Laurie Goldstein, anyway, one of the conservative commentators, columnists for the Toronto Star, for the Toronto Sun, was saying, you know, well, you know, you basically just can't have both. You can't, you know, look at the tar sands. You can't be progressive environmentally and still have jobs and growth. What would you say to that?
Well, I obviously don't agree with that. Might even be a little ridiculous because there are more jobs now in green technology than there are in the oil sands jobs. And there's all kinds of investments we could be making in high technology and high tech and green tech types of positions. And we can make investments in training courses and education in those areas, even things like wave technology. There's lots of research going on in that now out west and in the state. We can harness the power of the waves, but that all takes high technology, and it takes skilled workers, and we can focus on that to create jobs. And even things like something that Canadian Business Magazine gave Elizabeth May kudos for talking about was, and this also relates to infrastructure, so that we know investments in infrastructure create jobs, but retrofitting all our public buildings, hospitals, schools, museums, universities, the whole bit of public buildings. If we can retrofit them for a high level of energy efficiency, we can create a lot of local jobs and skilled jobs, and also reducing our carbon footprint. Apparently 30% of our carbon pollution comes from leaky buildings, as they say. So that bridges the two. We're reducing our carbon footprint while creating local jobs and stimulating the economy.
We're certainly hearing from conservative quarters that a carbon tax or a cap and trade program, that these are just job killers, that this is going to tank our economy. This is just going to be a tax on, you know, those who can least afford it.
Yeah, of course they say that. I don't think we can expect them to say otherwise, really, you know, with their history.
No, but you work in the security industry. You work in a business environment. Is that the general thing you're hearing? Is that the general opinion, or are you finding that opinion shifting? I thought it was very interesting that, you know, Mark Carney, came out and talked about climate change as a serious business issue.
It has huge costs if we don't address it, and we do know that places that have a carbon tax, like BC. And places in Europe, that the economy is doing very well, and in Scandinavia. So the evidence proves otherwise, that it's not job killers, that it doesn't hurt the economy, and it can actually be good for the economy. Plus, with the carbon tax, which is our preference versus the cap and trade, we are advocating for carbon tax and dividend. So it's not a carbon tax that would just tax and go into general coffers, but the dividend then would be paid out to Canadians. So you pollute the bad, and Canadians get a dividend back according to income. So the lower income earners would get more of a dividend than the higher income earners. So it's only good for everybody. It does put more money back into the pockets while making the polluters pay.
So obviously, because you're the Green Party candidate, you're hearing about the environment at the door, and you've said you're hearing about housing issues. Is there something else that you're hearing in Etobicoke-Lakeshore that we should be aware of?
Well, the lack of infrastructure planning, like I mentioned before, but really, truly, the biggest thing I am hearing is that people don't want the Conservative government in anymore. That is really is the number one thing I'm hearing for the most part.
Which doesn't bode well for Mr. Trottier.
No. But, as we were talking about the polls just recently, he still has mid to high 30s percent, so which I find actually kind of surprising. But that is what I'm hearing. It seems like people want a change. They want a more progressive government again.
Well, thank you, Angela. I've been talking to Angela Salewsky, who is the Green Party candidate in Etobicoke-Lakeshore. Thank you so much, Angela, for agreeing to be on Three Women. And all the best to you as you walk and talk and knock. And do let us know how it's going. I will be commenting, on a mainstream media show on the election and it's going. So I'll be watching. Take care.
Well, thank you very much for having me. I really appreciate it.
So just to get back to the basics, you are listening to Three Women. It, of course, is CIUT 89.5 FM. I, of course, am Sherry DeNovo, MPP Parkdale High Park, and you can reach me.